Tyres are obviously one of the most important things we have when it comes to race car performance. I've got Jared here from University of Canterbury Motorsport, and we're going to be talking about tyre tuning and tyre selection on one of their Formula student cars. So, hey Jared, we've got a couple of your cars here behind us. I can see one's a combustion and one's an electric, and obviously here we've got wet tyres fitted to one car and slicks to the other. But can you talk a little bit about how you guys go through a tyre selection process, what sort of parameters you're looking for, how do you actually choose what you're going to build the car around?
Yeah, absolutely. So a big important thing for us is about the grip levels we're able to get out of the car, given the events we're going to be doing. So within Formula SAE, we have a range of events, given from acceleration, very simple straight line test, straight through to, you know, full endurance running. So we want a tyre that's able to give us the most grip over a series of different events.
And what sort of tyres have you got available to you? I presume it looks like these tyres are made specifically for these sorts of cars. So what sort of range of options have you got? Brands, sizes, big, small, wide, narrow?
There's a real difference between a lot of tyres throughout the FSAE community, should I say. Everything from an Avon semi-slick, which is similar to what you'll see on a Formula Ford, straight through to the Formula SAE specific tyres we see that we have from Hoosier here. So there's a lot of different brands, there's a lot of widths, a lot of heights, and that's very dependent on what people are looking for in terms of tyre temperature, you know, how much RPM you're running, what your wheel speeds are going to be, how much you want to try and work the tyre, what your car weight is, all that kind of stuff really builds into how we decide where we're going to get to on our final tyre.
And where does that tyre selection process come in as far as the whole car design? Is it a case of designing the whole car around the tyre? Is it designing some of the car and then let's think this is the tyre for us? Where does that come in the design process?
It's definitely been an iterative process over the years. So we've changed our compounds and the tyre we use based on our performance from previous years. So you take what we've learned from the previous years, we kind of go, okay, we're happy with the performance, but our longevity wasn't enough. Let's look at a slightly harder compound that's going to last longer. As we know, our car is going to be similar in weight and similar in performance to the year before, hopefully a little bit better, but it's mainly that we look at what we've done previously and base it off that.
So obviously, being part of the university, you guys have got enormous access to resources as far as simulation and computing power, probably much more so than the vast majority of race teams, really. So how do you guys leverage that? What sort of information do you get about the tyres, and does that come from the tyre manufacturer? Do you have to test yourselves? Where does that come from?
So there's a Formula SAE consortium which gets data from Calspan International out of Europe. So they do all the test rig for tyres specific to Formula SAE. We're able to take all that data and make our own MATLAB scripts, and that is able to extract all the data we want out of it and gain predictive models of the tyre in multiple ways.
So when you say tyre model, what exactly does that mean? What information are you getting from those tyre tests? And when you say model, what is that going from and to? What are you giving yourself there?
Yeah, so it's all about, for the tyre model, is about having basic outputs and inputs. So for our inputs, we have our normal force, which is the tyre acting down from the load on the car, and you're also looking at the slip angle going through the tyre. So from that data, we're able to look at it and go, okay, what's our lateral force coming out? What's our longitudinal force, our aligning moment, and our overturning moment? So those are based off of testing from a big belt with a test rig, where they have all the data and sensors. They record all of that, and all we do is data fitting to that through a MATLAB script, and then that's transferred through.
So this is essentially taking discrete points of data and fitting like an analytical curve through it, so you can essentially look up the forces at any combination of vertical load, camber, slip angle, stuff like that?
Yeah, absolutely. So our specific model is known as the Hans Pacejka magic formula, which a lot of people use and a lot of professional teams use to semi-empirically define the performance curve of the tyre.
Got you. And what about validation? So we've talked a bit about the selection process, how you guys go about that. But when you get onto track, what are you using as far as sensors or back-ending that validation to really understand whether you made the right decision?
Yeah, so we've got our linear potentiometers, acting on the dampers, which is looking at our loads acting through the corner. We've done a bit of work going on the normal force acting through all of our push rods so that we can start to interpolate how much normal force we're getting through, and then we're able to look at what we should be expecting in terms of grip levels through corners, and we're able to use that in terms of our GPS and all our other sensors to bring that together to go, okay, this is what we should be expecting from a lap time. How good are we doing comparative to that?
And how does that validation process usually work? Do you find the tyres are usually behaving as you expected based on the data you gathered before from the simulation, or is there usually quite a big difference?
Relatively. We're slowly working through an Adams model of the car to simulate a lot of quasi-static kind of setup for the car and how it's going to do our lap times. We're getting pretty close between our physical model, our MATLAB model and our Adams model. So we're pretty happy with it at the moment, but it's a very long process to get that to a full track simulation.
What about tyre pressure? Like, what's the typical sort of hot tyre pressure you guys would be targeting for a car like this? What sort of range? I'm sure you don't want to give away all your secrets, but give me some idea of where you are.
Yeah, and this is probably a really big thing comparative to normal racing. We're running really low, like we're talking 13, 14 PSI hot, maybe a little bit more, but yeah, because of how light the cars are and how wide the tyre is relative to that, we're looking at really low pressures to try and really work the tyre and gain the most grip out of it.
Got you. And like you said before, there's a range of different styles of events you guys do. You do an acceleration event, which is essentially a drag race, and you've got autocross and endurance, which is much closer to something like circuit racing or a sprint. Are there many differences in the tyre pressures and the way you set up the tyres for those different types of events?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, it's all that kind of stuff that we're used to, like camber and toe and tyre pressure. We're basing all of that relative to the events we're doing. You know, the way we set up for acceleration is totally different. We want to have the car to be able to run well in a straight line. We want to be able to squat nicely. We want to be able to get the most grip out of the back of the car mainly. So, you know, we're lowering the pressures in the back. We're making sure that we can get optimum traction off the line. And then from there, you know, moving all the way, say, through to endurance, we're looking at having a more steady car throughout the distance of the race. We want to be able to make sure we're not increasing too much tyre wear. We want to not be putting too much camber so that we're not wearing the inside wall. You know, all those kind of things that you would normally see in normal racing.
So from what I understand, the autocross event is essentially a single lap, and the endurance is a similar lap but many times over. I don't know how long you go for, but is the way you set the pressures for the autocross, does that mean you're starting with a lot higher cold pressures in order to achieve the right hot pressures within one lap?
Yes, definitely. So because we want the car to be on straight away, we're looking at increasing our pressures straight out the gate so that the car is on straight out and we're able to have within the first 300 meters we've already got hot tires. You know, we put that in with a bit more increased toe so that we're able to just generate a lot more heat so that we can make the most out of a one lap dash.
Interesting. So how much sort of, what sort of difference in toe gives you a measurable difference in your initial tire temperature like that?
Oh, hard to say. As you said, I don't want to say too many of our secrets, but you know, we're not talking too much. You know, we're talking a couple of degrees is really enough to work these tyres. They are a super soft compound, so really, you know, especially with the four-wheel drive systems, it's working in a lot of different ways, and it gets a lot of heat quickly. So you don't need to do anything majorly drastic to the car.
So from what I understand, the electric car behind us here uses a torque vectoring system. You were saying earlier that you're one of the drivers for the competition. So for that torque vectoring system, how does it feel for you in the car? Do you have to drive it quite differently from, say, a normal combustion rear-wheel drive car? What is that like in the car for you?
Oh, it's totally different. You know, one, going to the electric is a totally different, you know, kind of beast, really. You know, we're talking about something that's got instant torque. Wherever you put your foot, you're going to get the power you want. You know, relative to waiting for a combustion car with its power curve, you know, where you're working through your rev range, this has the same power throughout that whole range up to maximum speed. So first of all, it's about learning that and getting used to that working well. And then once we implement our torque vectoring like we have on the car, we're able to load the car up and we're able to keep on the gas through the corner even up to the apex a lot more because we're actually able to generate more grip when we've got a little bit of gas on. The only hard thing with that is that if you start to get a little bit of oversteer action going on, as soon as you lift off the gas, like most people will, it'll just really come round on you. So
is that something you find, is it much more difficult to drive, or is it just something it's really, you've really got to get used to it?
I think it's just a matter of change. You know, it's a matter of understanding what's underneath you, taking a little bit of time to adjust. But in terms of the car being different, you know, it's not harder any other way. It's just a matter of changing your style.
And what about a sort of performance increase? Have you been in a position where you've been able to back to back the car with and without torque vectoring? Is it, does that, what sort of percentage increase in performance do you get?
Oh, major. We've probably seen over, say, a 30 second lap stint that we do at our test track, we're talking about a 1 second difference of drop in time.
Yeah. So it's pretty massive.
Huge.
From a driver's perspective with the electric vehicle over the endurance distance, is that a situation where you have to essentially energy save because of a certain amount of energy in the battery that you've got available?
Yep, so we also use regenerative braking. So first of all, we turn our power down and we use regenerative braking. So we're able to use a multiple system, so we're not using as much power, but we're also trying to bring power back into the system when we're braking. So one, that means we wear our brakes a lot less, but we're also, and we're able to trail brake the car in with regenerative braking, but we're able to power ourselves out, which hopefully in time, once we start to understand our electrical systems a bit better, we'll be able to reduce the size of our electrical package and reduce the weight of our car.
And as far as the amount of regenerative braking you can get, are you able to harvest everything? Do you still have to, some of the conventional brakes still have to do some work? Is there a limit to that?
Usually when we're doing an endurance, we base ourselves to only brake with regenerative braking. So we're talking about 15 kilowatts of braking power, which in one of these is near on lockup.
Right. Okay. So you, when you talked about having to turn the power down for an endurance event, is that more of an energy limitation of how much energy you've got to complete an endurance event? Or is it more about maybe a reliability thing, making sure you don't cook anything during that run?
Yeah, so it's a little bit of both. So temperature is a really big thing. You know, the more power we pull through the electrical system and the batteries, the hotter it gets, and we do run into issues if we have any of that. But as well, it's about part of the endurance attempt is to have the best efficiency possible. So we're trying to get a matter of trying to get the best compromise between getting a really good endurance time and finishing well in that, as well as having our best efficiency possible.
Got you. Thanks very much for the talk, Jared. That was really interesting. Some really fascinating stuff and going off with these cars.
Cheers, mate.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.